to the Sunday show and for the speaking out about the death of Dennis Benedict.
Thank you.
Coming up, how an Iraq war veteran is navigating the deep divisions in America right now. Journalist David Finkel joins me live in studio to discuss his new book that explores what it means to hold on to our values and sense of hope for this country's future.
Praise and worship the name of the Lord on today. You ought to stand on your feet right now and help us sing this song. It goes like this, you ready? Sing. We love to call your name. It's something we cannot explain. That happens when we proclaim your great name. Your great name.
Oh!
right now. Come on, come on, come on. Woke you up this morning, starting you on your way. God, you've been good to me. God, you've been good to me.
When you have your way, something has to break. It's held down every lie. Set the wrong thing right. 'Cause when you have your way, something has to break. Get me to it.
the Civil War freed millions of slaves, it also freed slaves from having to worship in white congregations or in secret. But even before emancipation, many slave preachers established their own independent congregations. Among these men were Richard Allen and Absalom Jones, who established the African Methodist Episcopal Church. Allen led a small group of Christians who wanted to leave St. George's Church, but did not want to affiliate with the Protestant Episcopal Church. In 1794, Bethel AME was dedicated in Philadelphia with Allen as its pastor. Allen had been a slave in Delaware, and to keep white Methodists from interfering with his church, he sued in 1807 and 1815 and won the right of his congregation to exist as an independent institution. The church didn't really begin to grow until the Civil War and Reconstruction, when its numbers swelled to more than 400,000. Today, the African Methodist Episcopal Church has membership in 20 Episcopal districts in 39 countries on 5 continents. I'm Monica Pearson with This Week in Black History.
Good evening. I'm Donna Black, the Beaufort Area YPD Director, and welcome to the Beaufort Area Black History Program. Now for the protocol. We give honor to Bishop Samuel Lawrence Green Sr., Supervisor Dr. Phyllis N. Green, Sister Sandra Anderson, SEDWMS President, Sister Tara Simmons, SEDYPD Director, Brother DeAndre McCray, Interim SEDYPD President, Sister Myra Haney Singleton, SCCB WMS President, Sister Barbara Stanley, SCCB YPD Director, Sister Jordan Kinsey, SCCB YPD President, Reverend Philip C. Anderson, presiding elder of the Beaufort District, Sister Sandra Anderson, Beaufort Area Consultant, Sister Vinnie Mitchell, Beaufort Area WMS President, Sister Donna Black, Beaufort Area YPD Director, Sister Nia Taylor, Beaufort Area YPD President, local pastors, YPD directors and helpers, parents and children. Welcome. We will now begin our Black History program with the doxology by the Campbell Chapel Young Voices of Praise, Call to Worship with Nia Taylor, our Beaufort Area President, and Julius Jenkins, the Beaufort Area Treasurer. Lift Every Voice and Sing by the Campbell Chapel Voices of Praise, Prayer by Robert Young Jr. from St. Stephen's, Scripture by Andrew Guest of Queen Chapel. Oh.
To me, let us go into the house of the Lord. Our feet shall stand within thy gates, O Jerusalem.
For a day in thy courts is better than a thousand. I had rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than to dwell in a tent of wickedness.
Because of the house of the Lord our God, I will seek thy good.
Those that be planted in the house of the Lord shall flourish in the courts of our God.
Blessed are they that dwell in thy house. Lord, I have loved thy habitation, the place where thy honor dwelleth.
For the Lord is in his holy temple. Let all the earth keep silence before him.
Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer.
O sing unto the Lord a new song, for he has done marvelous things. Make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all earth, and sing praises.
Silent tears, thou who hast brought us. is our God where we met thee. Blessed our hearts, drunk with the wine of the world, we forget thee. Shadow beneath thy hand, may we forever stand true to our God, true to our name, till end.
Giving us another day on this journey. Thank you for those strong men and women who paved the way for us and showed us that if there is a will, there's a way. I also want to ask that you bless those who fight for racial equality for us in today's generation. I also ask that you lay a healing hand on the wounds of racial injustice present in this country. I ask that you heal those wounds and let this country become one. I also ask that you touch the future generations and let them know that a change is going to come. I ask that you give the future generations the strength that you gave our ancestors and let them know that it's not about the size of the fight, but rather the will that you have in the fight. Dear Lord, I also ask that you heal the sick and lead the lost and let them know that you are still with them. In your name we pray. Amen.
My name is Andrew Guest, and I'm from Queen Chapel Amy Church. Please turn to Matthew 5th chapter verse 3-12. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. Blessed are those who persecuted because of righteousness, for theirs is kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people insult you, persecute you, and falsely say all kinds of evil against you because of me. Rejoice and be glad, because great is your reward in heaven, for in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you. For God's word and God's people. Amen.
Let us now listen to our soloist, Aiden Babyface Singleton from St. John Cottageville. next, we will have a Black History presentation from Allen Chapel. Princess Bennett and Myra William, Pastor Keith Parker and Darlene Rumpf, local director.
Somebody asked me, what is the color of black? Well, we have two of our YB viewers from Allen Chapel AME Church who are here to just explain it to you a little further about the color black.
Blood is the color of black. Every shade, every hue is beautiful. Every strand, coil, braid, or weave tells the story of love. Love of self, family, friends, heritage, and tradition.
Hope is the color of my black. I am the tears and smiles of families past, present, and future. It is the toddler, student, parent, and elder looking for new days and adventures. It is the closing part in the chain of events that will show the world who it is and what it can accomplish.
Faith is the color of my black. It is the worry, fear, and pain of a people still waiting for a change. A change that will give rise to a generation of renewed minds and strength.
A generation that believes that they are not forgotten or forsaken for being tested and are willing to take the test without fear.
The color of faith believes that our Father in heaven watches over us and protects us at all in trouble.
It's Black History Month, and we're going to hear from Chantal Smith, who is from Mount Pisgah, where the pastor is Thaddeus Smith, and the local director is Denisa Singleton. Kalimba.
Dreams, for if dreams die, life is broken. Life is a broken winged bird that cannot fly. Hold fast to dreams, for when dreams go, life is a barren field frozen with snow.
Amen.
Kenyana Meggett is going to take us up, up and away. She's from Greater St. Mark, and the pastor is Reverend Maxwell, and the director is Miss Glenda McPherson.
I bet you don't know who Bessie Coleman is, but that's okay, so we're going to read about her today. Bessie Coleman. Who is Bessie Coleman? Bessie Coleman was born January 26, 1892. When she was younger, she worked in the cotton fields and attended a segregated school. She saved up money to go to college, but after one semester ran out of money. She eventually went to France to get her pilot's license. Bessie Coleman died in a plane crash on April 30, 1922. 26. Her determination to become a pilot was inspirational to women in the African American community. Why do we remember her? She was the first African American woman to hold a pilot's license. She was determined to become a pilot, and the United States didn't have any good flight school options for African Americans or women. So she went to study in France. Notable achievements and accomplishments. Bessie Coleman not only received her U.S. pilot's license, but she also studied to receive her international pilot's license. She also became a skilled air show pilot. Amen.
Gianna George from Greater Calvary is very reminiscent of the scripture. King Hezekiah, talking about muddy waters. Let's pay close attention. Pastor Cecilia Jenkins and the local director is Jacqueline Beasley. Listen carefully.
Who am I? I taught myself to play the harmonica and guitar while growing up in Mississippi. My real name is McKinley Morganfield, but you know about my other name. In 1943, I moved to Chicago to play in the club and brought my first electric guitar in 1944. My electric sound helped bring about the beginning of rock and roll. I was inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame in 1987. And I am one of the founders of Chicago Blues. I am Muddy Waters.
Everybody gather all around. For St. Mark's kids, we got a gang about us. Red light. Reverend Maxwell is the pastor. And Miss McPherson is the director. Red light.
Say it louder.
Garrett Morgan.
Zoe. Chloe. What does red mean?
Hold stop.
It. Turn it around. What does red mean?
Red means stop.
Raleigh. What is yellow?
Slow.
And green light. What does green light mean?
Go.
Go. So who made the signal light?
Garrett Morgan.
And he was a what? Who was that? What?
Black
man. Black man. Let's give them a round of applause. Thank you. Y'all go to your seat. And those of you who didn't get treats this morning, there will be some treats in the back. Take to school.
We'll have a solo performance by Thomas Miles from Grace Chapel, where Reverend Janine Smalls is the pastor and Miss Serena Miles is the local director. Victoria Guest from Queen Chapel, where the Reverend Edward Austin is the pastor, and Dr. Andrea Guest is the director, will give us an up-close and personal interview.
Good evening. My name is Victoria Guest, and I'm the Vice President of the Beaufort District YPD. Today, I'm talking with Sister Gresham for our Black History Month celebration. First, I would like to ask her a couple of questions, like how was it like to integrate into an all-white high school?
Well, that's something I'm trying to forget, but anyway, it was hard, very hard. When we were given the opportunity or the, you know, we could choose whether we wanted to integrate the all-white school or stay at the school that we were in. So a group of friends and I, we decided that we were going to integrate the school. We talked with our parents, and our parents agreed that, okay, if you want to do it, we'll go ahead and let you do it. But it was hard, very tough, because we went through a lot with the racial, barrier. The kids were very, very rude to us, and we did not have a lot of people at the school, teachers backing us. There was one teacher, especially, that she would tell the white kids not to do that, but not very many teachers were behind us on that. But the kids were very, very rude to us, but we bear with it. After the first year, a lot of students, the black students, could not put up with it, and they went back to Michael C. Rodden. But a few of us stayed there, and we bared with it, went through whatever, but it was rough, I'm telling you, it was.
My second question is, at the time, did you know how important it was that you integrated into the high school?
Yeah, it was important because we wanted to make a point of showing to break the racial barrier. We wanted to integrate the all-white school and let them, we wanted the education that we knew that they were getting at the white school that we weren't getting at the black school. You know, we were trying to show that the black children are just as smart, and you know, we wanted to also show that break the racial barrier, you know, that we could compete with the white students just as much as, you know, we could compete with the black students too. So those were the things that we were trying to show, that, you know, black students can do just as much as the white students could do.
My third and final question is, are you happy that you decided to integrate in the end?
I thought about that, and I'm glad that we did it, because we were like the, we were the ones who started everything, and we made it better for the students to follow when they had the full integration. But sometimes I look back on it and I say, it was rough. I'm telling you, it was very rough. We had to go through a lot of things, like walking through the hall, and the white kids would say, if you brush against them or anything, they would say, and touch, and make us feel bad. They would put a sign on the water fountain with white only, that we couldn't drink from it, but we would do it anyway, you know. And sometimes I look back on that and say, why did I go through it? But then I say, it was good, because we made a way for the students and the children that followed us. And I guess when they did the full integration, it was a lot easier for them to relate to the white kids, and the white kids found out that, you know, we were normal people just like they were, and they started feeling a little bit better toward the black kids when they were total integration. But in a way, it was good. It was rough. Sometimes I wonder why we did it, but anyway, it was a trailblazer for the children following us. So.
Thank you, Sister Gresham, for taking the time to answer these questions, and I hope that you have a lovely Sunday.
Thank you, and the same to you. And thank you for giving me the chance to let everyone know what we went through and that it was good, it was bad in a way that it was good too. But thank you.
From Campbell Chapel, where the Reverend Dr. John R. Black is the pastor and LaChina Hamilton is a local director, we have Nia Taylor. She'll be giving us a personal historic bio. Amira Brown, who will be giving us another personal, serious bio. And Bree and Brian Hamilton will bring us a special selection.
Good morning. I'll be speaking about my ancestor, William Still. All right, William Still was born in Burlington County, New Jersey. His father, Levin Steele, had been enslaved, purchased his own freedom, and changed his name to Still to protect his wife, Sydney. Mrs. Steele had tried to escape once before she succeeded, but could only bring two of her children with her. William Still had little formal education, but studied whenever he could. In 1844, William moved to Philadelphia. In 1847, he found a job as a clerk and janitor for the Pennsylvania Society for the Abolition of Slavery. He soon began aiding fugitive slaves, often sheltering them until they could find their way farther north. One fugitive was his older brother, Peter, who had been left behind when his mother escaped 40 years earlier. These experiences led William to save careful records about the people he helped. Meanwhile, Still purchased real estate, opened a store selling stoves, and later founded a successful coal business. Before the Civil War, Still had destroyed many of his records about aiding fugitives because he feared they would be used to prosecute people. After the war, his children persuaded him to write the story of his exploits and people he helped. Still's book, The Underground Railroad, is one of the most important historical records we have. Although Still recognized the many contributions of white abolitionists, he portrayed the fugitives as courageous individuals who struggled for their own freedom. Thank you.
Today we'll be talking about Malcolm X. Malcolm X was an American Muslim minister and human rights activist who was a prominent figure during the Civil Rights Movement. He was born on March 19, 1025 in Omaha, Nebraska. He was a spokesman for the Nation of Islam until 1964, when he became a vocal advocate for black empowerment and the promotion of Islam within the black community. Malcolm X was emerged as the principal spokesman of the Nation of Islam during the 1950s and early 1960s. He organized temples, founded a newspaper, and led Temple No. 7 into New York City's Harlem. Elijah Muhammad appointed him the nation representative of Islam, the second most powerful position in the NOI. Thank you.
Today I'll be reading about Ignatius Sancho. Ignatius Sancho was born on a slave ship off the coast of Guinea, West Africa, and was taken to a Spanish colony of New Granada in South America. When he was 2 years old, he was brought to England. He grew up enslaved to three sisters in the town of Greenwich. Later, the Duke of Montagu bought him. Despite Sancho's enslaver, the Duke helped him to learn to read and write. When he was older, the Montagu taught him literature, writing, and music. After the Duchess of Montagu died, Sancho was freed. He married and opened a small grocery store. He was probably best known as a public intellectual, publishing many letters about abolishing slavery. Sancho was responsible for a number of important firsts. He was the first black composer in history to ever have music published. He wrote songs, minuets, country dances, and also published a book on music theory. He was also the first black person to vote in the British election. When he died, he was the first black person to have an obituary in the newspaper. Today we'll be playing Minuet number 15 by Sancho.
Next, we have a triple presentation from Grace Chapel, where Reverend Janine Smalls is the pastor and Sister Serena Miles is the local director. We will hear from Roxana Logan, Gage Jones, and Ryder Jones.
Good morning. Good morning. I will be accompanying Roxy as she speaks of this profound artist. All right. We hope that you enjoy it, and we know that you know this person very well.
Gail Burns is a self-taught aspiring artist who paints in acrylics and loves to paint landscapes, seascapes, and whatever strikes her fancy. She has no particular painting style.
She holds two bachelor degrees, one in English and the other in early childhood education, and a master's degree in science, but has no formal education in training of the arts.
In fall 2017, a surprising gift of art supplies from one of her children promoted her to find new ways to learn how to use them.
She draws inspiration for some of her pieces from places she has been or seen or totally from her imagination, which we all know that she has a very vivid mind. One of her favorite things to do is paint likely images in unlikely places.
Ms. Byrne currently lives in Laurel Bay area of Beaufort County with Bruce, her husband of 45 years, and her dog named Sassy.
Thank you.
Independent, simple-minded education grounded him securely in family, faith, and public service. He later served as an employment counselor and director of two youth and community development programs. He joined the staff of Governor John C. West, becoming the first African-American advisor to a South Carolina governor. President Barack Obama, he has said he is one of a handful of people who, when they speak, the entire Congress listens. James E. Clyburn is the assistant Democratic leader in the United States House of Representatives. He previously served as the House Majority Whip for over 10 years. Congressman Clyburn has led efforts to preserve and restore historical buildings on the campus of historically black colleges and universities, HBCUs. He sponsored legislation creating the South Carolina's National Heritage Corridor, the Gullah Geechee Culture Heritage Corridor, the Congaree National Park, the Reconstruction Era National Historical Park, and expanding the Brown v. Board of Education National Historical Site to South Carolina, Virginia, Delaware, and Washington, D.C. Dedicated to making America's greatness accessible and affordable for all citizens, has been expanded to 15 accounts of the appropriation bills. Additionally, his Rural Energy Savings Program provides loans to families and businesses to implement durable, cost-effective energy efficiency measures. His accessible, affordable broadband for all was funded at a level of $65 billion. Mm-hmm. Congressman Clyburn and his late wife, Emily England Clyburn, met as a college student protesters in Orangeburg, South Carolina. South Carolina jail in 1960, the encounter led to a 58 marriage, and they became parents of three daughters, grandparents to four grandchildren, and great-grandparents to one great-grandchild. Whitney Houston, American singer and actress who was one of the best-selling musical performers of the 1980s and 90s, the daughter of Emily Sissy Houston,
Obama, the 44th president of the United States. When Barack Obama was elected president in 2008, he became the first African American to hold the office. The framers of the Constitution always hoped that our leadership would not be limited to Americans of wealth or family connections. Subject to the prejudice of their time, many of them owned slaves. Most would not have foreseen an African American president. Obama's father, Barack Sr., a Kenyan communist, met his mother, Stanley Ann Duham, when both were students in Hawaii, where Barack was born on August 4th, 1961. They later divorced, and Barack's mother married a man from Indonesia, where he spent his early childhood. Before fifth grade, he returned to Honolulu to live with his maternal grandparents and attended Panay School on scholarship. In his memoir, From My Father, 1995, Obama described the complexities of discovering his identity in adolescence. After 2 years at Occidental College in Los Angeles, he traveled to Columbia University, where he studied political science and international relations. Following graduation in 1983, Obama worked in New York City, then became a community organizer of the South Side of Chicago, coordinating with churches to improve housing conditions and set up job training programs in a community hit hard by steel mill closures. In 1988, he went to Harvard Law School, where he attracted national attention as the first African-American president of the Harvard Law Review. Returning to Chicago, he joined a small law firm specializing in civil rights. In 1992, Obama married Michelle Robinson, a lawyer who had also excelled at Harvard Law. Their daughters, Malia and Sasha, were born in 1998 and 2001, respectively. Obama was elected to the Illinois Senate in 1966. And then to the U.S. Senate in 2004. At the Democratic National Convention that summer, he delivered a much-acclaimed keynote address. Some pundits instantly pronounced him a future president, but most did not expect it to happen for some time. Nevertheless, in 2008, he was elected over Arizona Senator John McCain by 365 to 173 electoral votes. As an incoming president, Obama faced many challenges, an economic collapse, wars in Iraq and Afghanistan, and the continued menace of terrorism. integrated before an estimated crowd of 1.8 million people. Obama proposed unprecedented federal spending to revive the economy and also hoped to renew America's stature in the world. During his first term, he signed three signature bills, an omnibus bill to stimulate the economy, legislation to make health care more accessible and affordable, and legislation reforming the nation's financial institutions. Obama also pressed for a Fair Pay Act for women, financial reform legislation, and efforts for consumer protection. In 2009, he became the fourth president to receive the Nobel Peace Prize. In 2012, he was reelected over former Massachusetts Governor Mitt Romney by 332 to 206 electoral votes. The Middle East remained a key foreign policy challenge. Obama had overseen the killing of Osama bin Laden, but a new self-proclaimed Islamic State arose during a civil war in Syria and began inciting terrorist attacks. Obama sought to manage a hostile Iran with a treaty that hindered its development of nuclear weapons. The Obama administration also adopted a climate change agreement signed by 195 nations to reduce greenhouse gas emissions and slowly global warming. In the last year of his second term, Obama spoke at two events that clearly moved him. The 50th anniversary of the Civil Rights March from Selma to Montgomery, and the dedication of the National Museum of African American History and Culture. Our union is not yet perfect, but we are getting closer, he said in Selma, and that's why we celebrate, he told those attending the museum opening in Washington, mindful that our work is not yet done.
Let's give our young people a hand. Thank you, children. Thank you, children, young and old, for your participation and your sacrifice. Thank you very, very much. And now it's time for offering. Please give a free will offering by Cash App, $BlackDonna1, or mail checks to the Beaufort Area YPD, 1720 Promenade Lane, Bluffton, South Carolina, 29909. Thank you. You better hunch your shoulders with Thanksgiving. We're gonna do things, good things with it. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this offering. We thank you for the hands and the hearts that gave. Let it multiply your kingdom and encourage those and set a fire in everyone's heart in Jesus' name to serve you. Amen.
Amen. That's it.
Praise the Lord, everyone. I neglected to mention Jaden Babyface Singleton's pastor, that is Reverend Shirley Pinckney, and Deneen Brock is the local YPD director. We have t-shirts for the retreat. They have come. If you have not ordered a t-shirt, they usually have them there at the retreat. But yeah. Okay. There you go. Anyway, you'll see when you come to the retreat. And we also have Self-Denial Books, for $15. And the theme is Breaking Free, Elevating in Christ, and Establishing a New Me. Keep the children active in the AME way with self-denial. And I'll have these at the retreat as well. Moving on. We would like to acknowledge our leaders. I will want to know, is Sister Myra Haney Singleton on the air? Is she in the room? Sister Myra Haney Singleton? Miss Tara? Miss Tara Simmons, are you here? Would you like to have words? Moving on down the protocol, Sister Barbara Stanley, would you like to have words?
Good evening. I greet you in the joy of knowing Jesus. Sister Donna, you've done an excellent job with the YPDers, and I would like for you to continue to do the work that you're doing. They did an awesome job with Black history, and it's never enough that we teach our children our heritage and our history. So continue to do the work of mission. This is my prayer for you. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Sister Barbara. You are a woman of class. I appreciate you. And Sister Vinnie, would you like to have words?
Good evening, everyone, to the established protocol. I just would love to say that, Sister Donna, you did it again. And it was just so great to see the various, the various presentations that were done. It was just not all songs. It was reading from the musical selections to the up close and personal interview. And then you, as you always came up with something different to make the presentations so entertaining. So hats off to you and the YPDers, and continue to do what you're doing, and I'll see you on Friday.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you, friend. Thank you very much. Thank you. And before I speak to Sister Anderson or the elder, I want to thank all the pastors who are present. I really appreciate your presence. And you bless me with that. We have a great attendance of 44. Thank you very much. Sister Sandra Anderson, are you on the air? Is the elder present? Do we have any other YPD officers from other areas present that would like to have words? Wonderful. Well, we are going to move on to our closing video. We will see you at the retreat. Stand by for the benediction. Thank you. There is a rose at Campbell Chapel. Her name is Nyla Bolden, for the closing prayer. Pray, Nyla.
And close your eyes. Dear Heavenly Father, praise you for the blessings you have given us this day. Please forgive our sins, watch over and protect us, heal us and keep us safe. Help us to grow closer to you. In your holy name, Jesus, pray, amen.
I wonder as I wander out under the sky, how Jesus, the Savior, did come for to die for poor ornery people like you and like I. Poor
as I wander out under the sky. In the name of the triune God, may the spirit of Christian mission enter every heart. May the spirit of Christian mission enter every heart. If you'd like to have anything to say tonight, you may unmute at this time.
Darling, this is Sister Canick. I applaud you and the YPDers. You did an excellent job tonight along with the young people.
Thank you, Sister Lucille. Thank you. I love you.
First Lady Black, this is Sister Rickenbacker. I'm here just smiling all over myself. We are so proud of you and the work that you are doing and all of the children in the YPD.
Thank you, ma'am.
First Lady Black, you did an awesome job, phenomenal. The children, the presentations were awesome, diverse. And it gives us something to think about. God bless you and continue to do the good work.
Thank you, Reverend.
You're welcome.
She's not as Brother Williams. You did a wonderful job.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. That the shiki colors look good on you. Those are your colors.
Thank you.
Well, everyone go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
Amen.
Good night.
Amen. Good night. Great job. Good
awesome night. Job. Amen. You all made it possible. Thank you.
All right.
Thank you. It's a cool day. This is wonderful. I love the props. It's nice to see the young people showcase their talents. Thank you.